Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Art Speak TV and Radio here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer this morning, and we're going to spend half an hour with Elisa Hale from Goodspeed Musicals Downriver. And even though Goodspeed was shuttered down like everybody else during the pandemic, they certainly produced some wonderful virtual programming. And in case you haven't seen the concert that John Cullum did recently, celebrating his 91st birthday, that was brought to you in part by Goodspeed, and an up-and-coming concert by Christiane Knoll, who appeared many times at Goodspeed and also was in Next to Normal at TheaterWorks. So Goodspeed's been busy. Elisa, it's great to see you.
It's wonderful to see you too.
How have you been making it through the pandemic? I know that you were furloughed for a while and working. Are you back now to work and everything kind of opening up again at Goodspeed?
Well, it's been very interesting. Our opportunities changed. We had to pivot, obviously. And in terms of back to work, it's multifold. I haven't really been to our grand home on the Connecticut River more than a number of times that maybe I can count on both hands in over a year now. Like many other artists, it's been a long time since we've actually set foot inside the theater space, been able to collaborate with one another in person. So we're really looking ahead as things continue to progress for that opportunity. In the meantime, we did a lot online. You know, we're all Zoom meetinged and gone digital, which is really exciting because it gave us an opportunity to change the way we creatively present and produce work that we can share with our audiences and possibly build new audiences and for growing that passion for musical theater, even if it can't be that traditional experience of seeing a show on stage. So programs like Great Speed and In the Home Office, which highlights new works and up and coming emerging writers, was really exciting. We have a podcast, In the Spotlight podcast, that's co-hosted by our artistic associates, Annika Chapin and Michael Fling, where they do a deep dive into one musical every episode. And it's not just dramaturgical, it's historic, but it's also very lighthearted and passionate because they're both musical theater fans at heart. And they do a diverse range, you know, being that we're Goodspeed, some of it's looking back at groundbreaking historic musicals like Showboat, but they also are looking at newer works and seeing how they fit into the canon. And of course, we have now with our new leadership, Donna Lynn Hilton as artistic director and David Bird as our managing director, they've been doing a program called In the Green Room with. And early on, it was a companion to our Goodspeed On Demand Passing Through with the writing team of Passing Through, and then a second one with the cast of Passing Through. And then they've done one more recently, and we're looking forward to doing one with Christiane Knoll as well.
Yeah, I saw Passing Through, and it was something that I had wanted to see at Goodspeed, but at the time, the press were not invited to the second theater at the Terrace Theater because these shows were in development, and I was totally wowed by it. It was one of the, not only was it well filmed, but what a great piece of work, and I sure hope that goes to Broadway or other theaters, because I sat back and watched that. I could have watched it three or four times in a row. And
we got chills. It's something that we were really fortunate. It's a truly homegrown Connecticut musical. Brett Ryback and Eric Ulloa, who have both worked with Goodspeed before, were taking part in our Johnny Mercer Writers Grove at Goodspeed, where they came together and started developing the show. So we had little tastes of it early on. It had progressed to the degree that it was something we chose to include into our Festival of New Musicals a few years ago. So we saw that first shot on its feet in front of an audience, even though it was just a reading. And we knew there was something special. The audience response was really quite incredible. And so the obvious next step was a developmental production at our Terrace Theater. And like you say, it changed so much just in those few weeks. That is why we typically close those productions to the critics, because they're not finished.
Right.
But the audience certainly has a say, and what they were saying was there's something here, and it certainly had garnered a great deal of attention, and hopefully that this pandemic and our opportunity to present it on demand proves to not be just a blip, you know, just a blip in its process and its journey, and not a stopping point.
I would assume that, and maybe the numbers can back it up, but I would assume that by your streaming this, or the John Cullum concert, which is really wonderful, and I'll come back to that, but by streaming this, that it gave people all over the world a chance to see what Goodspeed does. And the Terrace Theater is so small that only a limited number of people could get to see any show there, let alone a show at the Opera House, because it's so small. And this gives people around the world who have heard of Goodspeed a chance to experience it firsthand, that you probably now have fans and followers all over the place.
Well, it certainly was an exciting opportunity to look at it positively, given that we couldn't produce what we had scheduled. This is an exciting alternative. Of course, it's still about word of mouth. So now everything is online, and we rely on our fans on social media and for people who converse with their family and friends to kind of spread the word. It's tricky because, you know, we still have to find that way to get the message to the world, starting with the audience who already knows who we are. And of course, you know, as you talk about numbers, when you have a downtime like this, where people have had to be furloughed and hours are limited, and we simply have no revenue, you know, there is no advertising. So it really is about social support. It really is, more than ever before, what we need in terms of our engaging with our audience, not just what we put on stage for you to enjoy or on the screen for you to enjoy, but there's a conversation, there's an exchange there. And what we ask is, instead of that standing ovation, share it, tell people.
Yeah. Although you did a benefit performance or a benefit concert in the theater back in the fall. And I was astounded by that, because there was a young actor who had starred in Anything Goes several years ago, Rashidra Scott, who kind of did this song coming down the grand staircase in the Opera House. And I thought to myself, I can't even, clutching the railing, make it down that stairs, let alone sing and dance. But it was just such an uplift that Goodspeed was putting out material like that when everybody else was just like, not.
Yeah, it was an exciting creative endeavor. And, you know, a great deal of the credit goes to Donna Lynn Hilton and our team, the folks from development, to decide that since we couldn't have our annual gala, which is usually a fundraiser and a way to bring, you know, interest, but it's usually not attended by the bulk of our audience. This was an opportunity to take something very special and unique, and again, not just do it as an acknowledgement and a celebration for our current supporters, but something that we could reach all over the world with, and express the kind of joy and love that we have for performing in that beautiful, iconic space, and the wonderful talents that our audience has been fortunate enough to get to know over the years, and put it all in one unforgettable package.
You and I had talked right before the shutdown. You had come on and we had previewed the 2020 season in the Opera House, which was three shows, and all three got canceled or postponed. And tentatively, you're putting together a 2021 season to start in the fall. Rob Ruggiero, who was slated to direct South Pacific last year, had been on talking about TheaterWorks. And I asked him how far along was South Pacific when things shut down. He said it had been designed and pretty much cast and was ready to go into rehearsal. And that's the show that likely will come back in the fall of 2021 if conditions permit. What happened to the other two shows?
Well, we're not entirely sure. At this time, the plan, the hope, is that we will be able to invite audiences back into the Goodspeed this fall for South Pacific, because as you said, not only did we have the show cast and they were about to start rehearsals, but our scene shops and our costume shops had been working since winter. So there is a set built already, and there are plenty of costumes at the ready. And of course they were set for the cast that we had. So, you know, fingers crossed, we will be able to finally come together with that entire South Pacific artistic community to present that show that has been so greatly anticipated now for a very long time this year. And then Anne of Green Gables, which is a world premiere production of a new musical by a wonderful writing team, is going to happen in 2022. I don't have much information about timing and we're very deliberate about the slots, and it has to do with availability of the creatives and everything else. And then Candide is not gone. It just hasn't been put on a specific roster. And again, that was something that we were working with Darko Trejnik on. And I think that likely the intention would be that we want to work with his vision. So it all comes down to timing and availability and where it fits and, when it's the right moment for exploring that option again.
For people that don't know or really aren't aware of Goodspeed's history, and you see a piece like John Cullum at 91, which amazed me because during the bicentennial in Washington, I was just a box office guy at Wolf Trap. And as part of the bicentennial, Wolf Trap brought the Broadway company to Vienna, Virginia, in the foothills of the Blue Ridge with John Cullum. And I got to see Shenandoah on a huge stage. It's one of the major shows that played Broadway that originated at Goodspeed, along with Man of La Mancha and Annie, and more recently Irving Berlin's Holiday Inn. Goodspeed really has a tradition going back years of producing new musicals.
Yes, it's one of the things that we are really known for. We are the first theater in the nation to receive two special Tony Awards. And in addition to that, we have quite a history, as you said, of fostering new works and moving them on to Broadway or off Broadway, the West End, Greater Life, national tours and everything. And so they are shows like you said, Shenandoah, which John Cullum originated the role of Charlie Anderson on the Goodspeed Opera House stage back in the 70s. And then he went on to play it on Broadway and win a Tony Award for Best Actor. The shows at this point, I think we have 21 shows that have gone on to Broadway, and over 90 shows have been launched both from the Opera House and, of course, the Terrace Theater, where we do just that, new works. And some are being seen overseas, like The Story of My Life that went on to Broadway, but has now gained popularity in regional theaters and in Korea, I believe. And, you know, it's been in Australia. I think, all of these shows continue to have a life, even if they weren't, you know, a multi-year run in a Broadway house. That doesn't mean that there aren't opportunities for audiences to experience some of these wonderful works.
And some of them get preserved. I mean, I saw Holiday Inn at Goodspeed. I did not see it in New York, but then PBS picked it up, and it's been shown on great performances. So Goodspeed musicals really reach a lot of people. You had the Festival of New Musicals over the year. That got canceled this year.
Yes, and that was multifold. The key element of that in addition to having the new works writers, it's sort of in residence developing over that 2 week span of time. It's really about working with the students from the Hart School and the Boston Conservatory who are learning the script and helping it get up on its feet for that, sometimes for the very first time. Sometimes there are things being written in the room so that what script they're presented with on day one, right after they are auditioned and cast all in one day, through to, you know, a week and a half later when we start the Festival of New Musicals on Friday evening, they continue to help the writers by seeing it up on its feet and seeing how things work to develop that earliest stages, those kernels of a new work. And without the classes being in person at the educational institutions and the knowledge that we wouldn't be able to have people on campus safely at that time, we looked to move ahead. And at this point, with the academic schedule and the housing and looking ahead to what we were hoping to do this spring with like our Writers Grove, which is just wrapping up now, it made the most sense to just put it off for the year, which was heartbreaking because it's something very special that we all look forward to every year.
You talk with a lot of your colleagues in theaters around the country. The pandemic really hit everybody hard, and particularly some of the administrators were laid off, but the actors that are out of work, the musicians that are out of work, where they had no other options and things to do, musicians that might perform in your pit or in your rehearsals, there were no bars or clubs or lounges for them to play and things like that. Are people starting to get back on their feet, or do you think it's going to take a long time?
I think it will take a long time to get back to where people were used to being. You are right that there was certainly a lot of loss. And I know that there was a point at which people found that there was a need to maybe rethink, at least temporarily. I know there was a lot of media about sort of a migration out of New York City, for example, and what was going to happen with that pool of artists if they move back to their parents' home in Arizona or whatever for a time at least. So it will take some time to come back together. I think that regional theaters are hopeful. We as an equity house are working with the actors union and the musicians union and so forth to make sure that all the guidelines are met and that we can keep the performers safe, as well as our audience and our staff. The other thing that I found as we were doing this is not just what happened online, but artists are creative and resourceful, and a lot of them had like side hustles. I know that at the holidays, for example, I bought several family gifts from a marketplace that was created by a bunch of artists who were putting out different goods and artwork for sale. So I had costume designers who made purses and, scenic designers who made jewelry and stuff. I know people who took over tutoring online and online dance classes. There was somebody in particular who I've seen perform in New York who apparently did like an online gaming thing. So it just, whatever your inspiration was, take it and shift it a little bit and see if you can find a way to work with it. But yeah, it's really been a hardship. And I know that, we're eager to start at welcoming our audiences back, but that also means that we're eager to start being a home for the artists again too, and be able to have them back.
I was amazed by the resiliency of some of the people who were laid off and all of that during the course of the pandemic. There's an actor who's based in Chester and Berkshire Theater Group who has a baking business on the side. All it took was for her to post pictures of her cookies and send them out to friends. And she became my cookie source. And the most famous one is Robbie Fairchild, who starred in An American in Paris, who always wanted to do floral arranging. And he had said that when he was in London with An American in Paris, he went to floral design school, and he's opened up a floral business in New York and pursuing that. So there were a lot of talented people that found other avenues of things to do. And my personal hope is that we all get that opportunity to come back to the theater where we live and breathe.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that is the goal, right? It's so funny. You know, I think that when people who are outside of the world of theater and performing arts, who aren't necessarily fans, regular audience members and consumers, really, don't necessarily realize until it's all gone just how much it touched their lives. Even people who simply just, you know, television stopped for a while and things shifted what you could consume on a regular schedule on cable. And of course, when you talk about things like extra work and side hustles, the stereotype is you're a working actor, you're a waiter, you're a hostess, you know that, but the restaurants couldn't work either. So the typical second job to pay the rent, to allow you to go to the auditions, all of that was also stunted, if not completely stopped. So the artistic community in particular was one of the most hard hit during this time and for the longest.
It's still not reopened. Need help.
We hope that it will come together.
Yeah. What happened to the little town of East Haddam where Goodspeed's located, where most of the shops and the businesses and the restaurants depended upon you delivering us several hundred people into town every day to see a show? When you talk about industry that wasn't arts related that suffered, that town of East Haddam is totally dependent on Goodspeed.
Well, we're very fortunate that they're wonderful neighbors, and they, you know, still go to the little coffee shop, and they still have an opportunity to visit the record store. And now that we're going into summer, hopefully the sweet shop will be ready to open up again. It's harder. The restaurants had a hard time, but they did their best to roll with the guidelines coming from the state and the CDC. To continue to open the doors to people. And of course, that just everyone, not just the artists, had to get creative, the businesses had to get creative. But we, again, are hoping to be able to be back soon so that we can visit those places and open our doors to our audience so that they can also experience all of those wonderful businesses again.
We're chatting with Elisa Hale from Goodspeed Musicals, and we're going to take a fast break to acknowledge the underwriters that keep us on the air week in and week out. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. I'm Mark Auerbach. If you missed a portion of today's program or you want to catch it again, it's stored on YouTube at WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. We'll be right back.
Underwriting for Community Radio on WSKB is brought to you in part by Rockies. Over 30 convenient locations throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Florida. One of the nation's largest Ace dealers. Expertise and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies, rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com. Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Comcast and Xfinity.com. Offering Xfinity TV, internet, home phone, and home security services. Information on all that Xfinity has to offer in the Westfield area is available online at Xfinity.com.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back, everyone, to Art Speed. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. We're chatting with Elisa Hale from Goodspeed, and we're talking about all of the contributions that Goodspeed has made to the art of musical theater over the years and the hopes that there'll be live music coming back later on. Last summer, Elisa, there was an outdoor concert series. Are you guys striving towards doing some outdoor things this summer?
Absolutely. We're really excited to be able to say that Goodspeed by the River is going to return this summer with expanded programming. The Goodspeed will be bustling under a big tent filled with several exciting events. Last year, we did a couple of different performers coming and doing some outdoor concerts. In this instance, we have made arrangements to put a tent up, which will allow us to do events rain or shine, and expanded seating so that the capacity is much greater. We obviously are still going to look at the guidelines from the CDC and the state to figure out exactly how all the seating will be done, but we obviously have the capacity now to welcome more people in to enjoy each of the performances. With the tent, we will also be able to do more performances a week. So for the majority of the calendar now, we're looking at acts and artists coming in starting in June and running to Labor Day. And most of them will have a schedule of something like 8 performances a week. So 7 p.m. on many of the weeknights, and then we'll add in a few of the weekend matinees to round out their schedules. And there are a number of different performers that we're hoping to announce very soon. Something for everyone, for sure. There are performances planned by Broadway and Goodspeed stage favorites that you know and love, wonderful show tunes and well-known songs and stories, as well as some presentations of new musicals, similar to like the festival, but kind of a concert version of works that we have been looking at but wouldn't be able to put down on our stages right now.
And we should tell people that if you're interested in finding out what's going on at Goodspeed, they have a website that has everything. It's goodspeed.org, and they've got a robust Facebook presence because I see Goodspeed in my Facebook feed quite a bit. And you have a newsletter as well, so people can sign up at the website for that.
Yes, and those are all great ways to stay in touch with Goodspeed and really have the finger on the pulse, because we usually announce to our audience using the emails and the newsletter first, and then we put it out to the general public. So when we have those shows that we're about to announce, those will be the first chance to know when tickets are on sale for each of the performers. And then, of course, when we know the schedule for South Pacific, it's another opportunity to know when you can get in line and get those tickets.
So let me, before we go, let me ask you a question. What did you miss most besides work and theater during the pandemic? So as things are opening up, were you the first in line for a latte? Was it going out to dinner? What's on your agenda as the world reopens?
You know, it's funny. I think that in all honesty, what I miss most is my family. I didn't have an opportunity to see the majority of them for an awfully long time. And that made me rethink what I wanted to do with my downtime once I could see them again. It is true that, you know, as you well know, I enjoy a good cup of coffee, and I abstained. I had not had visited our favorite coffee joint in over a year now. So I've saved money for sure, but I do miss it.
Yeah, well, I use my opportunity to walk every day because the gym was closed. I'd walk to our favorite coffee emporium, and unfortunately, they were shut down for quite a while. So I don't want to admit this to anybody, but I know how to make coffee at home now.
Well, at least you have an opportunity to fine-tune it and make it just the way you want it then.
Exactly. We've been chatting with Elisa Hale from Goodspeed. Elisa, thanks for joining us. I can't wait to see you in person in East Haddam at Goodspeed. And if you're interested in finding out what Goodspeed's offering, do go to their website and sign up for their newsletter. And try to catch the Christiane Noel concert that's running right now, courtesy of Goodspeed. Thanks for joining us, Elisa.
Yes, thank you so much. And do catch that. It's running through the 30th. And what's really neat is it's a co-presentation between Theater Works Hartford and Goodspeed. And all of the proceeds are split between the two organizations. So you'll help us both out greatly. And I look forward to seeing you.
We'll see you soon. And we're going to take another break to acknowledge our underwriters. And I'm going to come back and talk about something new happening in the creative economy in Western Massachusetts. So don't go away.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Dental. Comprehensive dentistry at 14 convenient locations in Springfield, Chicopee, Longmeadow, West Springfield, Belchertown, East Longmeadow, Ludlow, Northampton, Greenfield, and Wilbraham, as well as 29 Broad Street in Westfield. Bay State Dental makes it a priority to help you achieve and maintain the healthy smile you deserve. On the web at baystatedental.com.
Underwriting for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here.
Join me, Tina Gorman, each week from 6 to 8 a.m. for Wake Up Wednesday, when my guests and I discuss health, wellness, and lifestyle reimagined.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Arts Beat, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. And there's something exciting going on for the people that are involved in the creative economy in Western Massachusetts. Maybe actors who live here or work here, directors, designers, musicians, craftspeople, artists, people who teach the arts, and people who are peripherally involved, the restaurants, the gift shops, the tourism, the parking lots that surround our theaters and venues and filmmaking and all of that. And so when I learned about this program, I wanted to bring on two people who knew much more about it than I did. Dee Boyle Clapp from the Arts Extension Service at the University of Massachusetts. Says wave when I say your name because this looks like Hollywood Squares. And Lisa Duvall from the Franklin County Chamber of Commerce. These two people are involved in something new that has just been funded to a point by the state of Massachusetts in one of its programs, and it's going to create an arts hub for all of the people involved in the creative economy here in Western Massachusetts. So first of all, welcome to both of you. And I'm curious as to how this project started, whose brainchild was it, and who took the time to go get the money?
Yikes. Hi, Mark. That's a great question. Lisa and I will tag team a little bit. So the Creative Economy Network is a group of artists and arts organizations. They're primarily arts service groups that serve the various regions. So they're creative economy organizations, they're organizations like the RTCs, the Chambers of Commerce, and then individual organizations like River Culture, Arts Extension Service, et cetera. And we've been meeting for over 5 years, and we've had series of conversations with artists, listening tours, surveys, et cetera. And the all the artists kept coming back saying, we need this process, we need this thing. So the group has been working for over 5 years trying to come up with the best ways to serve the region, and that was one of the ways. So Lisa, I'll let you add more to that.
Yeah, there were a series of conversations. The Community Foundation of Western Mass also held a lot of listening sessions across the region, and many things came out of that. And one of them, again, was this: we need a central place for the creative community to find resources and to find a list of artists and to connect with each other. because so many of us in the network have been, people come to us and say, I'm looking for an artist for this project that I'm doing, or even non-related arts organizations like municipalities who are looking to have a concert series or something. Where can I find musicians? And we all would put the word out to our networks and say, oh, check this site out or check that site out. And really, we would just like to be able to direct people to one place and they could find anything that they need.
Yeah, well, it makes a lot of sense. I mean, I'm on one of the steering committees for the Berkshire Film and Media Collaborative and been helping them over the years. And I know they're one of the 21 organizations that are involved. And people come here to want to film a movie or a documentary or commercial, and they need to find out what the resources are, everything from where they can find a caterer to where they can find people to staff, locally staff things. And at the same token, with the pandemic, a lot of artists that might do one summer show here a year or be here on and off have moved up here because they didn't want to be in the big cities anymore. And there's this major need to connect. So I would assume that having this connection point now is much more essential than it might have been even a year ago.
Grant came from the Mass. Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, what's the timeline for pulling all this together?
It's a pretty tight timeline. Dee was about to say it came from the Mass Office of Business Development, this grant. And the timeline is really basically the end of the summer. So we have a lot of legwork to do right now to formulate committees, get the right people on board to figure out a strategy and to pull this off. So
people that are listening that want to be involved in some way, how do they learn more until that website is up, until things are up and running?
They can contact me at my email address, which is lisa@franklincc.org.
Okay.
And I can talk to them about what we're doing. And hopefully very soon we will be putting out some more structured information for the public.
Now, you work with the Chamber of Commerce, so you see the creative economy as something that's building Franklin County and to a larger extent the region. Dee, you work within the artists themselves, training them to be good administrators and training them to be a business, things like that. What if they come to Western Mass or they exist in Western Mass, what do they need to do to be successful in terms of either one of you want to take that question?
Dee does a lot of those trainings.
Right. We do a lot of trainings with artists and organizations as well. But to be successful, I think there's a couple things. One is to just get hooked in. Join your local Chamber of Commerce. Become known as a business, as an entity. Join the Creative Economy Network. We have a plug-in organization. We've got a series of Facebook events, et cetera. People can also go to the Arts Extension Service. It's just umass.edu/AES for Arts Extension Service and join our Facebook page. And we're happy to like share resources, et cetera. So I'd say to answer your question, what do people need to do to become successful? Get known, get people to know who you are. Plug in as much as you can so people can support and connect with you, you know, depending upon what it is that the artists actually do. If you're a performer or a craftsperson, there's always some event or happening where you can take part. And being aware of what those things are takes a little bit of time because there's sort of so much happening, which is why this hub is so needed. But once you get hooked in, it's easier to know, I can be part of this group show, or I can be part of this, you know, asparagus tour, whatever those things might be. There's so much to connect with. Artists are sort of known for working in isolation, but you don't have to in this valley.
Right. And the other thing is, my idea is a lot of artists don't think of themselves as businesses. They think of themselves as artists, and artists and businesses talk a different language. So they don't need to have a 5-year strategic plan if they're a musician to be a part of a chamber of commerce or a networking organization. They just need to have some skill set to put their word and their art out there for people to participate with.
as a person who teaches artists in business trainings, it's helpful to have that plan. But again, it's like, what's your vision? And also, who's your market? So recognizing a lot more about your business as your entities, and recognizing that if you want to sell things, you kind of are in business. That's a professional step to take. So we'll be doing a lot through the hub. We're also going to be doing a launch for the actual event itself. And we're going to be hosting entrepreneurs, arts entrepreneurs, just really focusing on the needs of artists. We're going to talk and have people come to talk about, how do you market your work and how do you use this hub to its fullest so that you can actually, you know, spend more of your time in your studio as opposed to hustling, trying to make a living. So there are ways that we can connect folks. One part of this grant also that came through is that we're going to be able to do some more artist and business trainings in the Valley to do this exactly what we're talking about. How do you do a business plan? How do you actually do a marketing plan? How do I identify who my market might be? And also, we always just want to explain to people that the core of who you are as an artist is essential. So we're not saying strip out your values. In fact, build off of what those things are, because that's the unique part of your business. That's the unique part of your work. So we want to help people build on what those, you know, what that value is.
Yeah. Do people have to live in Western Massachusetts to be a part of it, or have an office in Western Massachusetts? Are there boundaries that they have to be a part of in order to join the network?
Live or work, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, because a lot of the loans for small businesses that do support individual artists and things require, like, for example, we've had the director of the small business Massachusetts rep in the Berkshire say, you have to live or work in Massachusetts to participate in their specific program, but every state has their own. So I was just curious if... you had to live or work in Western Mass specifically to be a part of this?
Well, I would say generally yes, but one of the things we're doing is partnering with the New England Foundation for the Arts because they have a comprehensive database of creative organizations, of artists, of people that use arts organizations. And that is for all the New England states. So what we're looking to do is pull in the artists that live or work in Western Mass into this website that we're creating. But the primary profile is going to live on the New England Foundation for the Arts. And that gives the public a way to find artists around here and things to do and artists to buy from, but then also to collaborate and get visibility across New England. Because one of our artists, when they create a profile, can look for collaborate, like they can collaborate with someone in New Hampshire or collaborate with someone in Vermont. And then the New England Foundation for the Arts constantly promotes profiles and promotes all of the artists. So there's opportunities for artists that don't just live in this small area. There's collaboration opportunities and great visibility.
Yeah, I was going to ask, in the course of your putting this together, has the research come out? Do you have any idea how many people work in the creative economy in Western Massachusetts and maybe what kind of an economic impact it has?
I can't give you an actual number off the top of my head, but I can tell you that one in six people in the Pioneer Valley is connected to the creative economy. We have a really high, kind of a disproportionately high number of artists working in this region. It's one of the reasons it's so much fun. It's also really one of the reasons that we got this grant, is because this is all about economic development and helping everybody recover from, you know, post-COVID. As you know, Mark, the arts have been so hit so hard. So performers, artists, everybody, all the venues have been shut down. So everybody's been significantly impacted. So this is an opportunity to really sort of ramp up as quickly as possible. I just want to add one thing, which is that part of what this grant is also going to do is we're going to use it to help pay artists and pay writers. So we're going to hire 10 different writers to do interviews and profiles, as Lisa was just saying, of those individuals. And that's going to start to flesh out the website a lot and give people an idea of who's in your region, who's actually here making art that you may not have heard about before, or who's sort of moved to the area, or who's been a long, you know, Long Valley or Long Berkshire resident that hasn't really had an opportunity to have their story told.
I think it's a great idea. One of the things, the other things is that the four counties of Western Massachusetts attract the creative economy to the state. I know that movies are getting made oftentimes in Shelburne Falls, Lisa.
Yeah.
I need to go look at Shelburne Falls again to wonder why, because, I mean, it's a beautiful place, but what attracts a California filmmaker to come do a series in Shelburne Falls or on the North Quabbin? But when they come to town, a movie comes to film, they spend a lot of money here in town, so it ends up being a really good thing for us all.
Oh, absolutely. Well, Dexter's being filmed right now in Shelburne Falls. If you know that Showtime series, one of my students actually was talking about being on the set of this work. Shelburne Falls is a gorgeous community. It's also, you know, it's got the river, it's got the hills, it's got a lot of activity. So it's a wonderful place, as most Western Mass places are. I lived in Shelburne Falls for a long time, so I'm very partial to it. So we have a lot of resources here. We have that mixture also of, like, you can be out in the country in seconds, you know, literally just very, very get a lot of variety of scenery. The one thing that's so important about what you just said, though, Mark, is that artists and filmmakers have really advocated for tax breaks and for economic support to make sure that these things happen. And it's not just the artists and the actors that benefit, it's everybody. It's the hotels, it's the B&Bs, it's the restaurants, it's the gas stations, it's the electric company, because they're using so much energy. So there's a huge, it's a huge ripple effect that really affects so many people. And it's really positive for us. Also, you know, the Bridges of Madison County, when that movie came out a million years ago, tours, people wanted to go, I want to see where that was made. So tourists follow and they want to know what happened and they want to be in the same spot. So it's really exciting.
Yeah,
and that's what's good about the network, too. It's made up of chambers of all different kinds of organizations, so we can cross-pollinate.
Yeah, that seems so important. And it seems that it's been something I've been working in and out of the Western Mass for probably 35 years. Sometimes people are connected, and oftentimes they're not. So if this entire venture is successful, everybody stands to benefit from it. Not just an actor who wants to get a part in a play or a parking lot next door to a theater, but when everybody connects, it just crossbreeds into something much bigger and better.
Yeah, we all need each other.
We do.
Have a different role.
And in the first half an hour of today's program, we talked with the people at Goodspeed Musicals, and they've been shuttered except for some virtual performing for over a year. And they are the town of East Haddam, Connecticut. And East Haddam's restaurants and shops and services and gas stations and garages and everything else that shuttered when all of a sudden there weren't 300 to 400 people a day coming into town, or actors or designers or production crew and things like that. So I'm sure that some of the small towns here in Western Massachusetts really stand to benefit from a creative network that'll help them rebuild as the arts attempt to rebuild.
Mm-hmm. Another interesting thing about the Creative Ground database is there's a lot of opportunity to list what you do and pictures and sound bites and stuff, but also there's a section on who you've worked with. So that's a really good way of showing the types of projects that you're doing, people that the types of collaborations that are happening, who you're collaborating with. And it just is really great to spark those like ideas outside your narrow, sometimes people get into a box of like, this is what I do, but you can see the types of different collaborations happening, and it's great for that.
As both of you got involved in this initially, did you realize the extent that the creative economy existed here, or there have been a lot of surprises for you?
I'll just jump in. The way I met Lisa was a long time ago, actually, because we were both running our own creative economy program. Lisa was running River Culture, and I was hired to run Fostering the Arts Culture Partnership. These were both Massachusetts-funded creative economy grants. So if you're, yes, we both really got it. And we recognized not only, you know, Lisa basically helped transform a city with, and she would be the first to say, with city planners, with city administrators, with all the artists, all the folks, it's, you don't do this work alone. But what you do is you start to highlight what's already there. Every city and town in this state is humming with activity, but so much of it is unknown. And what creative economy programs do is help really to highlight all the activity and fun stuff and make people go, my goodness, I live in this place that's so rich. And they didn't really know all of that, all of those things, which is why this hub is going to be so fun, because you will, we'll talk more about this later, but we have so much to say in terms of a calendar. But at least I want you to be able to answer that question too.
Yeah.
River Culture is in the town of Montague in Turner's Falls. And when I started, one of the first things I did was create a central place for all the things happening, a calendar, all the events. And people were like, how did you get all this stuff going in such a short amount of time? And I said, you know, it was always happening. You just didn't know about it. And once you put it all together, it's like, wow, there's really a lot. You just have to go out and make the connections and put the stuff together.
And I think, you know, here I am in a studio in a small community that has a university and has a vibrant arts thing. And most people don't know Westfield other than as the former exit 3 on the Mass Pike as they go from the Valley to Pittsfield. And when I started doing radio and then cable here to learn about what's going on, I had no idea the amount, the breadth of it, and that. And so I know that there are, one of the things that I hope this thing does is you produce a calendar that people that just want to venture out in their own neighborhoods and communities or go one town over are going to learn about the wealth of people that are right in their backyards.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, calendar is key. And that's been an issue that's been raised over and over and over again. And that's going to be a really significant part of the hub, not to reproduce a calendar, but instead to pull all of these existing calendars into one location. Nothing is more frustrating for individuals, whether you're tourists or you are locals, to go, oh my gosh, I missed that thing, that really cool thing I would have gone to because you didn't know. Also because of, you know, how we each get our own news, it's really hard to stay up on all of the different calendars and events. So having the hub actually pull all these pieces together is going to be really important for us.
I would think so.
We don't really want to recreate a lot of things. We just want to maximize the exposure of the things that are already happening.
Yeah. How will this whole effort connect with the tourism effort to bring people? I mean, linking the creative economies together is kind of within the state borders, but how will it connect with the tourism and bringing people into Massachusetts and saying to them, hey, there's a lot to do here arts-wise?
Well, the chambers, my chamber and the Northampton Chamber of Commerce, we're both regional tourism bureaus, so we already fill that role, and we use our marketing money to bring people in from outside the area. And one of the places we will direct them is to this hub. And then we also have a direct connection with the Mass Office of Travel and Tourism, and we're always feeding them story ideas and you know, links to check out and to promote on their end. So that's the beauty of the collaboration and the network. We all have our own specialties that we could bring to the table. Tourism is certainly one of them.
So if people want to get involved and they're hearing this today, what's their first step to reaching out to be either get their calendars to you or to start the networking process? How long do they have to wait to jump on it and where do they go?
I would say that they should get in touch with me and let me know what they're doing and what they're up to. And I will add any resources that they have to the list as we start to compile everything. A conversation with me would be the start.
Okay. Lisa, why don't you give everybody your contact information so that if they're listening today, they can reach out.
My contact is Lisa@franklincc.org.
And you're up in Greenfield, right?
Yes.
Do you actually have a physical office that somebody could visit?
We do. It's 395 Main Street. It's across from the library.
Okay. And Dee, the Arts Extension Service is part of the University of Massachusetts, and you're on the Amherst campus. If people want to find out about the programs and services that you're offering, how do they reach out to you?
People can actually just reach out to me through our email address, which is aes@acad.umass.edu. Or again, if they want to just get, you know, information, they can also join our Facebook page. My email address is a little bit longer, so the AES ad is the best place to reach out to me.
And what about, you said that there's going to be a Facebook presence. Is that already there?
Yep. We fastest thing to do right now. We have a plugin, but the fastest thing right now is just to connect with us. So it's go to our website, which is umass.edu/AES. And at the very top of our website, there's a little Facebook icon. Click on that and join our page. And what we do is we'll send information out and just forward everything that the hub does for the summer. And then as we get ready to do the launch, like I said, we're going to have a big event. We'll have a big summit and we're inviting people to participate. It will be no doubt free, and it will be through Zoom as well, because we're not quite sure when we'll be all back in our regular offices.
For an individual or an artist to participate, I know if you join a chamber, you have to pay dues. That's part of the thing. And then you pay for any chamber breakfasts or events that you go to. In terms of this, will people to list or to participate other than events, is there a charge for people, or does this grant pick up the cost of that?
The grant picks up the cost of creating this all. And one of the strategies for partnering with NEFA, New England Foundation for the Arts, is that we want to make this sustainable. We don't want to start something that we're not going to have enough money to continue. And that database is funded with all of the creative cultural organizations, state cultural organizations all over New England. So they fund that. And NEFA also pays for all of the upgrades and the maintenance. So it will always live and it's free.
That's terrific.
Yeah.
What kind of social media presence do you think that you'll have when this thing comes up? Will people be able to find you on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram?
Yeah, we will probably continue with our plug-in to the Creative Valley Facebook page. And we'll probably develop hashtags and formalize more our social media presence. But yeah, we will definitely have. We don't want to create more listservs and more groups. Like, let's use what people are already on, and they're already on Facebook and they're already on some other places. So we'll just continue conversations where people already are and streamline that more.
Do you think down the road that you'll be able to get more support from, after this first grant, that area businesses that may not see the viability or see the visibility of the creative economy will want to jump on board to sponsor and things like that down the road?
Yeah, we're hoping.
Okay. Now, you guys have all been socially distanced during this pandemic, and things are starting to open up. Do you see the arts, as you're dealing with these various people in the creative economy, do you think by summer things will start to open up regionally?
They're already opening up. People are already figuring out ways to have events in the parks, you know, obviously events outdoors. The states basically just announced that venues can open to what's considered phase four, so there are more opportunities for more seats. I think it's going to take the participants a while to show up and to feel comfortable. But as everybody's getting vaccinated and as we all start feeling a little bit more comfortable with sharing in terms of how are we taking care of one another and distancing and all those things, yeah, I think that people are coming back. I can say that the university is planning to be back open in the fall.
Green River Fest is happening in August.
That's great. That's great. We're out of time, but I want to thank both of you for joining us today on ArtSpeak. And I hope that you'll keep me in the loop as to what you're doing, because as things progress, I'd certainly like to let our audiences know here what's going on, because we have not only members of the creative economy that listen on a weekly basis, but also people that are just generally interested in the arts. So Lisa Duvall and Dee Boyle Clapp, thank you for joining me today. And this wraps up another edition of Arts Beat. If you missed a part of today's program or you want to replay it, it's stored on YouTube at WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. We'll be back next Friday with another edition of Arts Beat. Peter Coles has been our chief engineer. I'm Mark Auerbach. We've been broadcasting from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. Thanks for being here. We'll see you next Friday.
Thank you so much for having me.
I know your eyes by heart. That look of half surprise. So innocent, so wise. I know that smile by heart. I know your smile by heart. And when it's this naive, there's something up your sleeve. I know that smile by heart. You're lean, you're lithe, you're delightfully blithe, disgracefully full of grace. So clean, so neat, so deceitfully sweet, is every feature of your face. And what's more, I know your heart by heart. It's light as a feather, tougher than leather, so I'll go on wondering whether we should be together or apart. I'm drawn to you, but I'm on to you. I know your heart by that cheating heart by. I know your heart by. I know your eyes by heart.
Just follow me, my dear.
That look of surprise, so innocent, so wise. I know those eyes by heart.
Don't think, just follow me. Have another drink and follow me.
I know your smile by heart.
You lost your balance.
And
I
when it's this naive,
so
there's
I
something up your sleeve. I know that smile by heart.
Don't worry, just follow me. And follow
you're
me.
Lean, you're lithe, you're delightfully blithe, disgracefully full of grace.
Above the world, we're so
clean,
let's
so neat,
let's fly.
So deceit.